it's Karuna here, and I'd like to speak about my personal story as it relates to narcissism and complex PTSD. And if you've been on this channel, you've noticed that I really don't speak about my personal background that much, and that is because I want to keep the emphasis on your well-being, your healing, your growth, all right? But today I feel it's important to share this story, and the reason is because I want this story, my story, to educate others about the effects of narcissism and complex PTSD, not only on the individual, but on our families of origin and in our communities and workplaces. So buckle up for the journey, okay? Because it's a big story, and here we go. My dad was a classic narcissist. Everything in the family revolved around him. All the needs, all the desires, all the children's interests, where we traveled, everything focused around my father. And of course, my mother was the classic enabler. She served all his needs. Everything was focused on my father. And as a young girl, I was very aware of my environment. I was very in tune with others and very sensitive, not boo-hoo sensitive, but sensitive as in aware of what was going on in my environment. And looking back now, as I see as a young girl, I knew on some level that my family of origin was shut down, that they were just incapable of showing and offering and showing love, offering love and behaving in loving ways. So we grew up in a ranch. I grew up in a ranch. Animals happened to be around. Goody, goody, right? So the animals, I poured all of my love into animals. I mean, all of my love into animals. I was up early in the morning before school. I was out with animals. I couldn't wait to get back home after school so that I could go out with animals. I'd come in very briefly for supper. I'd go back out with animals. Are you getting the idea, right? You know why, right? You know why I wasn't going to stay in the toxicity of the family of origin. I was going to go back outside. So I developed these incredible relationships with animals, and I have many, many stories to tell of love between myself and the animals, and also the trust that we developed with each other. So one day, a farmer who lived up the road came down to see me, and he didn't have much money, but he was so generous of heart. So generous of heart. He was the type of person that if there was something in his modest little garden, like a cantaloupe or tomatoes, he would bring it down to our family and just offer the extra cantaloupe or tomatoes. He was just such a sweet, kind person. He came down one day and he found me, and I was about 8 years old, and he said to me, "Would you like a little lamb? Because one of my ewes had a lamb, or had three lambs, and she's not going to take care of the third, and you can have the third one if you want." I was over the moon excited. We didn't have lambs. We had cattle and horses and dogs, some cats, but we didn't have any lambs, not one. And I was over the moon excited. So I took this little lamb in and I bottle fed it in our basement. And every 4 hours I would bottle feed that little lamb. In the middle of the night, I was up with that little lamb, and I just loved, loved, loved Penelope. Oh, what a great name, Penelope. Okay. So Penelope, of course, grew up thinking I was mama, and grew up thinking, I guess I must be one of the dogs because I'm hanging out with the dogs a lot. So Penelope was never in a pen. She didn't know about other lambs. And she was just walking beside me as a little kid, just like your dog would, exactly like your dog would. And that summer we went everywhere together. We went down in creeks. We got all muddy in the ponds. We went fishing. You know, I typically was a little Pied Piper. I'd have my horse and I'd have our two dogs, and then I had this little lamb, Penelope, and who knows, maybe a few cats. But I was just animals, animals, animals. Well, the time came that it was end of summer. And my father came to me and said, "It's time to take Penelope to the slaughterhouse." Oh, whoa, what a quandary. Because as a little girl, all my love went into this animal, and I was being asked to take that animal to the slaughterhouse and now kill it. I had so much trust. Penelope and I had so much trust between us. And now, as an 8, maybe 9, but I think I was 8, 8-year-old, I was being asked to go with my father to take Penelope to the slaughterhouse myself, right? And it's not like there wasn't plenty of land for Penelope to roam. There was plenty of land. So I listened to my narcissist father. I take Penelope up to the slaughterhouse. And the final vision I have of Penelope is Penelope desperately trying to jump over the holding pen. She was so bewildered. She had never been in any situation like this. There was chaos with the other lambs, and she was desperately trying to get over the fence to get to me. Now, do you think that this perhaps affects a child's vision of not only the family of origin, but of life in general? So when it came time, by the time these messages, I was inundated with these messages, growing up, but the time college rolled around, university rolled around, I had an eating disorder. Is that any surprise? And I literally was throwing up the values that had been force-fed to me. Values that did not align with my heart. Because that girl, that little girl from a young age who was aware of her environment, who was in tune, who was compassionate and loving, I was being layer upon layer of these values that were counterintuitive to everything I knew in my heart. I was being force-fed those values. So by the time I got to university, I had an eating disorder. 8 years of an eating disorder. Of course, 8 years, right? And during that 8-year time, of course, I had parents that were saying, something's wrong with you. Get over it. It's your problem. Whoa. Whoa. So I started reading and educating myself as much as I could. I started to go to therapists about eating disorder. I really started to study in earnest about eating disorders. All right. So the eating disorders healed, but that was the first step. Because then I started to ask, now, why would I have developed an eating disorder? Why would my sister be an alcoholic? And why would my brother have severe anger issues? This is not, quote, normal. In a loving family, in a truly loving, accepting family, this dynamic, I don't think it's going to pop up with all three of us. And as I started to become more educated, and as I started to untie these knots and discover mindfulness and meditation and yoga, the freer I became, the more tension there was in my family of origin. And no wonder why, right? It's no wonder, because I was developing my own identity. I was actually aligning with the identity of that which I always was. That kind person, that loving person, that loving, compassionate little girl, I was aligning with that. And not only was I aligning with that, I was exploring that identity. And the family of origin, specifically my father, had a real problem with that. So there was tension. So the tension continues. I'm becoming more aware. I'm developing my own identity that was always there in the first place. And I decide that I'm going to do this dance to keep contact between my son and his grandparents. So I go limited contact. I lived many, many miles away, and I decide to go limited contact. And I'm doing this dance back and forth, and I'm putting the spiritual principles that we read about, I'm putting them into place very diligently. I'm trying to be more loving. I'm trying to be more compassionate. The barbs would fly when I would arrive, and I would just either ignore them or just have some response that was generally used humor to try to diffuse the situation. But I do remember one time specifically that affected me deeply. And my son was maybe 10 at the time, and he was listening to his grandfather, my father, speak to me. And my son walked out of the room where my grandfather was and came up to me and looked up at me and said, Mom, I don't like the way Grandpa speaks to you. oh my gosh, that was such a big moment. Because he was picking up on this toxicity and his grandfather was not modeling a healthy relationship, right, with his mom, with grandpa's daughter, and with my son's mom. It was just not to be found. And when my son picked up on that, that was a big moment for me. But I still tried to keep this dynamic of going back and forth in place. Well, even with the most compassionate of people, there can come a moment that is the final moment. It's like the straw that breaks the camel's back. And here it is. You ready? Buckle up, everybody. Buckle up. Here we go. So I had taken my son back for one of these visits. And we, by that point, we were staying in a separate home, a little modest home that my parents had, because I wanted to keep some distance, but also keep the relationship going. And that was my way of creating balance. So we were staying in this little home, and for 7 days, I felt like I aced it. Like I helped my mom select the new dishwasher, and I got her the pedicure, and you know, I helped massage their aches and pains from being in older bodies, and the comments, those little, you know, barbs would fly, and I'd be like, it's all right, I got this. So the very final night, I'm there the very final night, and I'm thinking, good job, you did it. Yes, you can do this, you got this, right? And I'm all excited. And then my sister whips in. It's evening and she's breathless. And she sits down and says, do you know what's going on with the estate plan? And I said, no, I don't know what's going on with the estate plan. And she said, well, your brother and I and mom and dad, we all met a few times. And I thought, wow, I was completely left out of any of the discussion. And I knew this wasn't good. I knew it wasn't good. And please understand that my parents worked hard to create quite an estate, quite a large estate. And when I recognized that I was left out, I thought, wow. Number one, I was hurt because that final statement you make when you make an estate plan or will, on some level with children, that is equated with love and how much you love them. So there was the hurt part of me. But then there was the other part of me that was like financial planning. Oh my gosh, I have a son. Like I got to get my son through university and what's going to happen? And oh my gosh. So my sister provides this information. I knew it wasn't good information. I sit down with my parents that night. We're getting on a plane the next morning and I'm trying to describe to my parents through tears how I feel. And of course, a narcissist is not empathetic, are they? So they cannot connect with empathy or compassion. It's just not their language. And I have tears flowing and I'm not blaming. I'm not like mad. I'm just trying to understand. They won't share one bit of information with me. And you know what a narcissist does? They blame you. So my parents said, oh, why do you need to know? You're being greedy. Whoa. There was nobody home to talk to, which crushed me more, right? So I leave, I get on a plane and leave. And I decide I still want to see if we can have a healthy relationship. I keep going back and going back and going back. And I did it in the form of phone calls, but the phone calls were very even tempered because I knew enough not to get upset because the narcissist uses that as control and they call you the crazy one. So it was very even tempered, very even toned, tried to explain my feelings, which is like, you know, hitting your head against a brick wall with a narcissist. They don't get it. And they continued to call me greedy and they continued to be very critical of me and say, why do you want to know? Wow. So I had no clue of what was going on with this estate plan other than obviously my brother and sister are pretty set, right? So at that point, after hitting my head against the brick wall, after trying love, after trying compassion, after trying to keep a thread of communication going back and forth with my son and his grandparents, At that point, I realized I can't keep hitting my head against the wall anymore. And I finally went, no contact. Done. No contact. That was it. No contact. Well, guess my father would leave messages. And do you know, not one of those messages ever said, we miss you. We'd like to understand. The messages were a ruse. He would say, I hope this is the right number. Call me. Like a demand, like a narcissist does. Not one of those messages ever said, is there a reason you're not calling? The estate plan was never addressed, not once. And that's where it stood for a long time. My mother since passed, and I decided not to go back to the funeral. And the reason is, if I would have gone back to that funeral, it would have been like putting myself in a wasp nest and getting stung and stung and stung and stung and stung. Because the family of origin bonds together in all its toxicity, and they try to make the scapegoat wrong. And I was just going to get stung from every single side. Why would I want to put myself through that? Okay. So that's gone on. Now, the final thing I want to add to this was an occurrence that recently happened. My son, who's a lovely young man, kind, compassionate, I mean, you know, like the men we want to see in the world, empowered, takes responsibility, okay? He's a great guy, and I'm glad to have been on the front line of a narcissistic family so he can be healthy, and he's a pretty healthy individual. In my mom's estate plan, in her modest estate plan, this is separate from my father's, in her modest estate plan, she put a provision in there for my son, right? My father is actually the trustee of that, by the way. But there was a provision in there for my son, and it also said that educational support is important, and if there is a request for educational support, that should be considered. So, my son just went off to university recently. He's doing great. Could I use the educational support for my son? Absolutely. Could he use that? Absolutely. And, you know, we're scraping it together. He's on scholarship. He's working his tail off. He's great. But I thought, man, this would help so much just to get a little bit of educational support for my son. So I sent off a request to the family lawyer, asking for money for my son's education, knowing very well that I was unlikely to get it, but also knowing that if you are a family of origin and you're sitting on millions and the scapegoat doesn't have anything, who looks like the jerk if you don't grant educational support for a grandson, right? With that disparity, who looks like the jerk? Well, guess what happens? You already know what happened. They said no, and the comment was made that all the funds in my mother's estate are being used for my father's care, and that they hope that there's enough money in my mother's estate to care for my father. Signed, sealed, delivered, done. Okay? This is what happens in narcissistic families. This is the reality, the mess of it. You can have a family that's so toxic and so bonded and so set in their ways and their self-righteousness that they sit on millions, and the scapegoat in the meantime, right, is left with nothing other than, and this is important, her soul, her health, and a healthy son. They don't think that's much, but I'm telling you, that's what really matters. This whole narcissistic complex PTSD thing, it is literally a fight for your soul. It's a fight for your health. It's a fight for your wellness. And those animals that I had when I was so young, they breathed the life into me. They kept me alive. They kept me from shutting down when I was a young girl. They kept me from just numbing out and going along like the robots in the narcissistic family. They breathed life into me, so that I could heal and come full circle and save my soul and be on the front line and help create a healthy son. And the same thing is happening to you. If you're watching this video, it is worth it. No matter what situation you go through, this is a fight for your soul, it's a fight for your life, and it's a fight for the health of your kids, your community, and all those around you. All right? This is my my story about what's gone on in my life to date, but I know it's a fight for true well-being and true health. And I hope that this message ultimately inspires you. Do something with this knowledge. Run with it. Take that soul of yours. And yes, don't let the narcissist grab it, because they will try to be soul-sucking to the very end, even to the estate plan. They'll try to grab your soul and suck it down. Not going to happen, honey. Not going to happen. All right. I think that's a lot for today. Yeah? If you have any suggestions for topics for this channel, please put them in the comment sections below. And also, I'm open to doing private sessions with you. And at the end of this video, you'll see how to reach me. Sending greatest love and support to you on this journey.